This is TWiT.
When did you start Samasource?
2008.
Yeah. Three years out of college.
Yes, 3 years out of college and the worst month in the last 100 years. September 2008.
During the economic crisis.
Exactly.
Yeah. And it was a nonprofit.
Yes, it's a 501c3.
Yeah.
And I thought to myself, I want to build an organization that moves people out of poverty, but uses the mechanism of the market and especially this new kind of digital work to do that.
So this is a unique approach to it. I think one of the things, there's the Samasource website. One of the things that we see a lot of in this country is celebrities, I won't name names, but you know who they are, going to Africa surrounded by these poor African kids and saying, please give pennies because it can make such a difference in their lives. And I think that it looks to me a little bit more like the continuation of the white man's burden. Like, you know, we've got civilization and it's our job to, if we don't colonize them anymore, but it's effectively economically colonize people to give them, you know, what we have. You don't come to it from that point of view.
No, and you know, the thing about that model is that it's fundamentally patronizing.
It's horrible.
It sets up a relationship of us versus them,
yeah.
Where them are these faceless, nameless, poor people who are desperate and needy, and it doesn't require us to examine the structures that lead to that situation. And if you really believe that talent is equally distributed, which I fundamentally do, then the only explanation for such extreme disparities in wealth is disparities in opportunity. And that's what we aim to solve at Samasource.
Yeah.
We are about giving people work rather than aid, which is a much more empowering relationship. It's saying, I value what you bring to the table.
Yeah.
And, you know, we're going to show you that the market values what you bring to the table, even if you are a poor young woman from a slum in Nairobi, which is one of the toughest places to grow up in a slum in the world.
So, yeah, tell me about some of the places that you go and that we can make a difference in.
Sure. So, so I should say Sama means equal in Sanskrit. It's actually
nice.
The root word for same in English.
Nice. I like it.
And the whole mission of Samasource is to connect people who are living under the local poverty line, which in most developing countries is under about $2 or $3 a day,
wow.
And to connect them to work that pays a living wage through
right.
technology. So we actually manage what's now the largest data services company in East Africa.
Wow.
And all of the workers come from extremely low income backgrounds, so under about $2.20 a day. To give you an idea of what that's like, it means you live in a slum. So you live in a mud-walled hut with a tin roof over your head if you're lucky. You have no sanitation at home. You have no clean drinking water at home. You have no access to proper health care. You are often eating. We find that many of our workers at that income level before they start with us are literally eating sugar cane as a primary source of calories because it's so cheap. So you're really living a life that no human being should be subjected to in 2017. And very quickly, once we hire people, we quadruple their incomes. What's remarkable is they stay at that income level even after they leave Samasource. So they move out of poverty permanently. And we hire them to do what we call micro work, small digital tasks for large technology and data companies around the world.
Does this model work everywhere?
It has worked really well in East Africa. We have now about 1,300 full-time workers in Kenya and Uganda.
Doing what?
We also have a center in India and Haiti. They're mostly doing various tasks for technologies of the future. One of the biggest areas that we specialize in is image tagging for computer vision. So the teams that are building self-driving car technology and other machine learning technologies, making machines smarter, those teams need high quality data. And we provide that training data for those algorithms. So
yeah.
Believe it or not, you know, if you're in a car that's self-driving or that's experimenting with self-driving, that data may have been created by someone who has moved out of poverty as a result of this business model.
It's interesting. Instead of traditional manufacturing jobs or, you know, making things, the data economy allows people to make a living. It is still kind of, it's not manual labor, practically manual labor though, right?
It's we think of it as almost digital piecework.
Yeah, there's a good way to put it.
The benefit of this versus, say, a factory job is that by being connected to the internet every day, there is a huge benefit beyond just the income you're making. You get exposed to the knowledge economy. And that is a really powerful thing. We see many of our workers graduate to start agencies on platforms like Upwork, where
Neat.
You can make a good living as a digital freelancer. We see them for the first time joining Facebook and being active on social networks and producing content from places like a slum in Kenya. And I think that's really important. These people are becoming citizens of the future, not just workers toiling away in some factory who don't have an online identity.
Right. Yeah, sure. If you're assembling an iPhone, there's no graduation from that. You're not learning anything. It's a very specific skill. Yeah. And it's kind of mind-numbing. How are you helping, these workers learn more than just the simple data entry that they're doing?
Sure. Well, we set up as a nonprofit because we wanted the social mission to always be the most important thing in our company. And so,
but it's still a business in a way, isn't it?
Absolutely. It's a new category of business. We call it social enterprise or social business. Microfinance is another similar model. Mm-hmm. Many people watching the show might be familiar with the
Girl
Scouts.
Exactly. Yeah.
But even businesses like the Girl Scouts sell a lot of cookies every year. That's part of a social enterprise business.
It's a micro business, isn't it?
It's a macro business. It's probably like, hundreds of millions of dollars of Girl Scout cookies are sold. But it's actually a really smart way for nonprofits to build sustainability into their business. It means that I don't have to be entirely reliant on the whims of a few rich people to fund our operations. Although I'm very grateful for the rich people who did fund our operations.
Give them a plug. Who are your donors?
A lot of our donors are actually large foundations and institutions. Mm-hmm. So Google.org, the Rockefeller Foundation, Cisco, and eBay foundations.
A lot of tech companies.
Yeah,
it's interesting.
Yeah. Here in the Bay Area, Tipping Point has been a big supporter of our San Francisco program.
Right.
We actually have a domestic offshoot of Samasource as well.
And who are, so they're sitting, give me a kind of a look at what it would look like to be a Samasource employee in, let's say, East Africa.
Sure. Well, I'll use a story of one of my favorite young women who works for us, Martha Karubo. She actually was an orphan. She grew up in a slum in Nairobi, living on less than $2 a day as an orphan. She'd been lucky enough to get into this orphanage. And then, as happens here in the U.S. in the foster system, people age out. And so at 18, she was basically told, well, we love you, Martha. You're an excellent student. She was top of her class in her English classes, but she had nowhere to go and no job. It's incredibly difficult in a nation in which youth unemployment is 70% in Kenya. It's incredibly difficult for any young person to get a job, let alone an orphan from a slum with no connections.
Yeah.
So when I met Martha, she had just joined a training program. One of the nuns in her orphanage had recommended her to a feeder program. We work with a bunch of community nonprofits wherever we work at Tama that basically train people in some of our most basic skills. So she'd gone into this feeder program.
There she is.
Wow. Martha Karubo.
Look at that.
That was her, I think that was like 2 years ago.
That's an Instagram post. Yeah.
Yep. So when I met her, I mean, she's got her hair done here. She's wearing a nice shirt. When I met her, Martha would not look me in the eye. She was looking at her feet. She was wearing baggy clothes. She was so, she just seemed almost ashamed to be alive. She didn't have any self-confidence. And one of the things we take for granted is that if somebody's never had a formal job, never known anyone who's had a formal job, they've sort of internalized this message about themselves that
you're
they're not worth
worthless.
Anything.
Yeah.
Especially for young women growing up in developing countries. So Martha took this job. We measure people based on results. Her results were excellent. She started doing data entry. She crushed it. She was quickly promoted. The next time I saw Martha, like 2 years later, she was wearing a very nicely tailored dress. She'd gone to a tailor in Nairobi and gotten it. She'd done her hair. She was looking me in the eye. Martha since left Samasource and got a job working for a travel agency in Nairobi in marketing.
And I last saw her. You can see in that picture a confident young woman. You must be, you have an advantage because you're going there as a young woman yourself, a role model for them. You see, this is what's possible.
Absolutely. And I guess, I mean,
if I went there, it wouldn't be inspiring for them, right? It would just be another, you know, imperialist coming here to dole out dollars.
Yeah, I think what is remarkable is that ultimately, you know, we're all human. And when you feel those moments of connection, you realize, like, we're really all the same and we really want the same things.
Yeah.
And I think what's beautiful about giving work as opposed to giving a handout is it puts us on an equal playing field with the people that we are, I wouldn't even say helping, but the people who we're working
with. We're teaming up. I think that's so important. It's a pernicious thing, prejudice. And in the developed world, we often talk about the underdeveloped or undeveloped or third world nations, and it's a little bit kind of hidden. It's a little crypto prejudice because when we want to help them, we want to help bring them up. But it still comes, as you say, from a patronizing point of view that we somehow have it all going on and they don't. And those poor people, and we need to help them out. So I love the idea of, instead of just saying, here's a buck, of saying, let's get you a job.